We've sorted out what the paints are, all these different kinds that are on the market. Now it's getting down to the job which I hate most, and it's preparing the surface to get the painting started. Tony, is there ever the stage where you can put paint straight on paint that's already there without any preparation?
It's not advisable because it's very often such a shiny surface that the new paint wouldn't really grip to it very well, and that's where you get it scratching off. You know, if the children run their nails across it and it comes off, that's probably why it's happened, in that the surface wasn't prepared underneath. And all you need really is something like this. This is a stripping block.
Or pumice.
A pumice, yes.
Yes, a pumice.
And all I'm doing here is just taking the surface gloss off, that's all. It's not designed to strip the paint, it's merely flattening it down.
And you just wet it, that's all.
That's right. You merely wet it and rub it on there, give it a good wipe over, and you'll have a surface then which is ready to take a new coat of paint.
What if it isn't, and it's even worse? I mean, then that will sort out, in other words.
Yes, this is assuming that the paint's in good condition. Yeah. We can just slap some more paint over it. But if it's blistered, or if it's coming away, rather like this bit here, then you'd have to do something different. And the simplest way of dealing with it is to use a paint stripper. And thought perhaps you'd like to do that job rather than me.
I thought you were going to say that.
You can put your rubber
gloves
on.
I happen to have my gloves here with me. Yes, you suggest that you do, because if it got on the skin,
I think it's very wise to have rubber gloves on a job like this, because it is caustic. And if you put that onto the surface, and don't put it on like a paint, just sort of dab it on so that you get a nice thick coating. That's right. And if we're lucky, you will see very, very quickly the paint will start to come up. Now, what you must do is be very patient on this.
Certainly coming off on the brush.
You've got to, if there are, say, three or four coats on here, you may have to give two or three applications of this before you really get down to getting off. You won't hear very much.
I was thinking it was going to sort of make a hissing sound. As it be? Oh, look, you can see there, it's starting to come up.
That's it, yes.
So having done all that...
Having done that, and you've got it nice and soft, and of course, normally you would wait, say, 10 minutes for this to happen.
Yeah.
And as we wait, you'll see it start to bubble up. And then you would use a scraper.
It is beginning to
And on a flat surface, you'd use a scraper like this, and that will take off the... See, there's another coat under there, so we're not waiting long enough, but the scraper will take off the flat surfaces, and then you have these shaped ones, which will deal with the mouldings.
What, you mean round here?
So that one would get into that moulding there.
Yes.
The point would get into that bit there. Mm. So you can choose which face you want to get into to a certain position to get it off. Then if you get a really difficult corner, then you could use a bit of wire wool like this to scrape it off. But it is wise to wear gloves on a job like that. And another thing that's advisable is if you're working fairly near your face with a thing like that, it's a good idea to wear some safety specs, or if you wear glasses it doesn't matter so much, but these would protect your eyes against splashes.
I bet they look lovely on, don't they?
They're quite comfortable actually.
I feel like someone from outer space. But they have got the shields on the side, which is good and will protect your eyes.
That's it.
Sorry, thank you.
And they're designed large to go over spectacles, so you can wear them over the top.
You know the old-fashioned blow lamp, Tony? I mean, do people ever use that now to get off really tough paint?
Yes, it's still the cheapest way of doing it. We've got a very nice one here. Which is automatic. But where I wouldn't advise it to be used, except by somebody who's a bit experienced, is around glass like this, because if it's very cold outside and the heat of this on the inside, you could very easily end up having to replace the glass as well as do the decorating.
I'm sure. I'm going to stand back for a start.
But this one's got an automatic ignition, which is absolutely marvellous if you work up the top of a ladder. And with this one, we shall never talk about that noise.
No, well, that's illustrated what that
you've
does.
You've got to be very careful with this, and it is really better to leave it to the expert. It's also a good idea to have a bucket of water handy so that you can drop the burning paint into the bucket. Otherwise, you end up and never, never put newspaper on the floor
because
when
that
using
could
a
catch
blowtorch.
Fire.
Yes, your paint will drop off onto the paper, and you'll end up by burning the house down. Knowing about the paintwork. So yes, it's a good tool, and it's cheaper than using chemical strippers, but it does need an experienced hand really to use it.
What about, presumably, if you get all the paint off, are you all ready then to start putting the brush on with the paint?
Well, unfortunately not, because I think this side of the door gives us some idea that although we've got
this is what it finishes up looking like.
Yes, we've got the paint off, but you'll find the surface is very, very rough, so your next job is to smooth it all down ready to put your new coat on. You can do it by hand, it's a tedious process, of course. And remember, if you're using glass paper, always work with the grain of the wood. A lot of people make a mistake by going across it, but you work with the grain, and this ensures that you don't scratch the wood surface. If you go across it, then any little scratches you get, it's very difficult to remove. So always work, whichever piece of wood you're doing, work with the grain of the wood. But if you don't want to have so much elbow grease attached to it, then you could use a power tool. And I think most people are familiar with this little thing.
Yes, even I've seen that.
Which is the disc sander. And these are discs which go into that, they clip into there. And then this is put in a power tool and it revolves. But I did want to warn people about this. Because it's revolving, at some stage it will cut across the grain of the wood, unfortunately.
So really, your sanders are against using
I'm not terribly enthusiastic about this, because some people will say, well, hold it at an angle and it'll only touch. But even there, you're getting a cut across the grain, and it will scratch the wood quite a bit. So I think a much better tool to use is this one here. It doesn't have to be as big as that. You can get them in different sizes. But
what's that called?
This is a drum sander. And you put your belt of sandpaper on the outside of the drum, and you can see that it will revolve in one direction only, so that you can always work with the... Would you like to try it?
Yes.
I think it's plugged in, so...
Yes, okay. And you just press that
on. Yes, get a good grip on it, because it'll start to move as soon as you...
I can see already how the dust was flying on that, which is good.
Yes.
What about all these bits around here, Tony?
That again, you'd have to use either glass paper, or you could come back to your wire wool, which is quite a good abrasive to get into all these corners here.
But what about when you're painting around here, actually, and you've got to sort of, you don't want to get the paint on the glass?
Yes, I hate doing this sort of window, I don't know about you. But the thing that can help you in a job like this is to use a masking tape. Now, this one has an adhesive on the back which only grips enough to hold it in place. It doesn't, it won't pull anything off when you use it.
Which an ordinary sticky tape you might have at home would do, presumably.
Never use a cellulose adhesive tape, because if it's put onto paint, it'd probably pull the paint off, and that's an awful shame. And if you get it onto glass, you can't get it off, all the adhesive stays behind. So this would be put on, leaving about a 16th of an inch.
Why is that?
That's so that the paint does in fact contact the glass, and it goes onto the glass, and you get a seal between your frame and your glass. Otherwise, going back to the condensation we talked about, the condensation, if it dripped down the frame, if it can get into the wood, then you've got the
rot
trouble.
That's a great way of starting the rot setting in here.
And if you do end up with too much paint on there,
then
there's quite a useful little scraper, something like this, to scrape the paint off the window, and you'll notice that the blade is inset by about a 16th of an inch, so that it does leave a little bit of paint on the window frame. The idea is to keep it sealed. You should never use a razor blade and scrape right into the corners, otherwise this does allow the damp to get in.
Well, that's one great tip. You've got some more tips for us over here, useful little hints for painting, haven't you? I mean, I noticed the dust was flying there. What does happen if you get a hair from the brush in your paint or any sort of dust? What do you do?
Well, if people are using paint for the first time, they're not very experienced with it, it's a good idea to use only a little. Then if you should contaminate it by tipping dust in it or something, or putting it near your sander, you can change the paint. But this idea is merely to pick out any bits that you've got in the paint without straining all the paint. You fill your jam jar with paint, put a piece of tight or nylon stocking and fix it with an elastic band around the top, and push it. You see, I've tied a knot in the bottom of this, but push it into the jar, and then merely pick your paint up through the stocking.
That seems to me to be a very small jar, and you're going to have to keep refilling it, aren't
you? That's right, but it's very wise to do that, because especially for a woman, say, up a ladder, you know, to hold a litre of paint while you're working is impossible. Whereas that, you know, even if you dropped it wouldn't matter quite so much as if you dropped a large can. And you, as soon as you've used this bit, you can just take the stocking off, throw it away, and get a new piece. So.
You know, another thing that I went in the garage the other day, I've got tins and tins of paint, which have obviously got bits of paint left in them, and I sort of took the lid off and found that I got this very crusty top on them.
Yes.
Presumably those paints are going to be no use anymore.
No, you can sort of cut the skin off and use what's underneath, but I found that very often a lot of the oils of your paint are in that skin, you see, so it isn't quite the same as it was, and it's probably got bits in. A far better way of dealing with it is to take, when you've finished with a large can, find out about how much there is left, and then find a container which will take that amount of paint and fill it, So you fill your container right to the top, you put your screw top lid on, and there's no air in the container. That's what causes
That's
the
what
trouble.
That's what causes the crust, yes, I see.
If you have to use the tin that we've and to keep your paint in, then an idea is to cut a circle of foil from kitchen foil and drop it on the top of the paint
and then shut the tin.
And that'll keep the air away from the... Yes. Don't do what most people still say you should do, turn the tin upside down, because all you do, you end up with skin on the bottom, yes. You know, and people, then you then got to mix it, and it gets all absolutely horrible.
Another thing too, just while we're on the subject of sort of paint, is that I think it's very difficult when you get these colour charts in shops. You know, you get these tiny, tiny little bits.
Oh, yes.
How do you judge what the colour overall is going to look like from that tiny little bit?
It's very difficult on this one. If you look at a paint card, you very often find that the colour will look most attractive. But what you really need to do, if you're not sure, and it's a rather bright colour, look at the pink we've got, for example. It looks delightful in a little bit. But you magnify it up until you've got a whole room full of it, and you probably you'd never want to live in the room ever. And of course, it's very difficult once you've got it on. You can't change it. You've just got to cover it up. So I would advise people to, if they're doubtful about a colour, and let's face it, this is why so many people use white. Unfortunately, they're afraid of experimenting with the colour. Buy a little and try it out on an area, or get a shoebox and paint the inside and make it up into a little room set and see what sort
Gives
of
you a
general
good idea
effect
that
you get.
Way.
And you probably won't buy it, you know, you'll go for something different.
Yes, well, but, certainly with that colour,
it is a problem.
Which was bright,
they always look denser in large quantity than they do in little bits.
Remember that. Something else we've got to remember is how we take care of our brushes.
Yes, this is terrible, isn't it? Look at
yes,
this one.
Yes, it's a shocker. Stiff as anything.
The only thing you could do with this one, if it gets to this sort of state, and it never should, is to put it in this container that we've got our paint stripper in and give it a good old soaking. And after a couple of days, the paint stripper will have loosened all this, and then you can clean it with a paint cleaner.
Mm. But presuming that you're
never
going to take care
like
of it... what should you do generally from day to day to keep it?
If you take care of a brush, now this is a new one. Now, never use one like this for a top coat. This I would always use this on primer or undercoat, because it's full of little bits of fuzz, and it's got loose hairs in it, and you can work those out on the coats that don't matter too much. And then when it's been used a few times, then you relegate it to the top coats.
I see.
But that's a good reason for keeping the brushes clean. You said the longer you've had it, the better it'll be.
Can you do it in water? Or with emulsion?
Emulsions and the acrylics, you can do it in water. But if you have to use a paint cleaner, one of these chemical ones, rather than use a lot in a container, you could use a polythene bag. This is quite a useful tip. Just put a little in the bag. Put your brush into the bag. This is rather a large bag, but keep the handle out. Put it in, put an elastic band or a piece of tape round there, and all you've got then is your brush and your cleaner, and then you can work the brush through the bag. And you haven't got your fingers all covered in...
Because that is all part of it, isn't it? You have to clean the brush and then you have to clean yourself.
And I'm allergic to some of those cleaners. I come out in a rash if I get it on my hands, you know.
Yes.
So this sort of way you can get it clean without getting gunged up. Mm. Now, then you dry it and you get it nicely dry. A little elastic band around the tip is quite a good idea, because it holds all those loose bristles together. And then get a bit of kitchen foil, such as this, and just put the brush in it. This is cleaned, of course, and just fold it up, and that'll keep all the dust off it while it's until it's needed next time.
Johnny, good tips. The only one thing we haven't talked about, Tony, is the spray paints.
Yes, they're very popular, and perhaps we ought to have a look at something
along
those lines.
I think I'll bring my gloves with me. Are they expensive to use, though? Presumably they are.
They are quite expensive. So this one, you wouldn't use it on the door, for example, because you'd probably need two of those to cover one door, and you couldn't even guarantee getting the same colour.
Hmm.
So what they're really designed for is fiddly jobs, like this chair, woven chair, where you can see it's got masses of holes in it, and it would take you hours with a paintbrush trying to get in all the holes. Whereas if you use an aerosol, then you would fill it up very quickly. And of course, approaching it from different angles, you get in all the little crooks and nannies.
So it's anything that's got the tiny detail in it that you
that's
need to
it,
get
yes.
between. I mean, this has got holes between it.
wrought iron work, that sort of thing.
Yes.
It's quite good for that.
Yes. But then what worries me, you've got to be very careful what's standing in this instance, it's you, behind the chair.
Well, we would warn people about this because you get a lot of overspray with these things.
So it's good to put a big...
Yes, this is
can
just
I have
an ordinary.
A go and try
yeah,
and
do.
See.
Yeah. Give it a good shake first, Judith. You'll hear there's a ball at the bottom, a ball bearing, and that tells you whether the paint's mixed thoroughly. Don't point it
stand
in my direction.
Stand it about. Well, no, you've got a shield around
you've
it.
You've put a shield
around
it.
About what, a foot?
Yeah. And then just press.
Gosh, I am enjoying
it. Don't get too close. Come back a bit because what you must do is put on a lot of thin coats rather than one thick one. And this is where people. Keep moving. This is where people make a mistake.
<I'm trying. laughs>
If you put on too thick a coat, then it will start to drip.
So you just have to judge, because I mean, it looks as it's getting a pretty dense colour.
Yeah,
now.
Don't try and get it too dense, you see. We can let this dry for 5 minutes, and then you can come back and give it another
all
coat.
Right. Well, thank you very much indeed, Tony, for all your help and advice today. And I hope that you've learnt a lot at home, as indeed I have. But now, from good afternoon, it's goodbye.